Thank you for joining us this afternoon. This is a session from the National Park Service Chesapeake Gateways office, where we are sharing more details on our current grant offering that we have for the Chesapeake Gateways Network. Thank you for joining us. We are going to start this afternoon with what we call our Chesapeake Network triads. And so to get us started, I'm gonna just first, in a networking sense, introduce the team from the NPS that are here that are helping host this session. First, I wanna introduce Eddie Gonzalez. He is our NPS Chesapeake Gateways Partnership and Grants Director for the office. Bob Campbell, who's our head of Chesapeake Gateways Planning and Development. And our partners within the NPS that's been helping us with all of our strategic planning and our grants programming and our networking are with the NPS Stewardship Institute. So the head of the Stewardship Institute is Rebecca Stanfield McCallan. Thanks, Rebecca. And our partner in this project is Brent Mitchell with the QLF Foundation. So our team has, with NPS Chesapeake Gateways, likes to start with really being collaborative and making sure folks have an opportunity to meet other people within the network, to maybe connect with old friends or meet new potential partners and collaborators. So I'm gonna ask Rebecca to just tell us about what the triads are, and then we're gonna be sent out for just a little bit of time to meet some folks.
Thank you, Wendy. We do like to start all of our sessions with this opportunity for folks to connect. It is part of our strategic framework that we build the network, and you do that through having conversations and learning about those that are in your area across this giant watershed. So before we get into the content of the webinar, we're going to send you into triad. So there'll be three of you. And in that small group, it's your opportunity to share your name, the organization that you're representing, who you work for, what your connection is to the Chesapeake watershed, and a little bit of how you found us here today, what brought you to this session, what brought you to wanting to learn more. These are really short, you know, snappy opportunities to connect and maybe jot down, I want to go a little deeper with that person, or, you know, reconnect with an old friend. And we'll be doing this every time we come together. So if you're new and you join us again, you're going to have an opportunity to hopefully meet two new people. And if you've joined us in the past, hopefully you'll be connecting with some folks that you haven't had a chance to yet. When we come back, we'll move into the content and talk about this great grant opportunity. So Brent, I think we're ready. Remember the three things that you're doing in your triad: name, organization, and your connection to the watershed. What brought you here today?
Okay, here we go.
All right, as we slowly start to make our way back in. Thank you, everyone who was able to move into those small groups and share a little bit about yourself. I'm going to wait for the rest of the groups to join us. Almost all back in. I hope folks had an opportunity to meet somebody new and maybe reconnect with an old colleague.
All right. Well, hopefully, like Rebecca said, folks made some new connections, maybe reconnected. And what we'll do now is as we will shift into our presentation piece. So if Brent, if you could pull up our slides to get us started.
Yep. Here we go.
Yep, that's great. Okay. So on this page, I'll stay here for 1 second just to frame sort of how we're going to run through this session. So some of you might have joined us last week at the announcement for the new grant offering from the NPS Chesapeake Gateways Program. That was just a opportunity to kind of say it's live, we're active, provide the link to our new landing page that has all the information. What today is we're going to really purposefully walk through the background slides again on the NPS Gateways program to ground for anyone new, and then really methodically walk through what's considered the notice of funding opportunities. So the grant information sort of section by section. So the way we will run this is, you know, I'll provide some of the background information, then our director of partnerships and grants, Eddie Gonzalez, will walk through the grant structure and the pieces that are in the grant offering, but we'll stop and make sure we're taking time. If there are questions under the larger pieces of the grant program, we'll stay together from here forward as the full group. So we'll be watching the chat for any questions, and then we'll also pause to ask people to, you know, sort of come off mute and ask questions. We will do our best to answer as we go, but just understand that we are new to this. NPS Chesapeake Gateways next year will be celebrating our 25th year since the establishment of the Chesapeake Bay Initiative Act that you see a quote here from that. So while we've been at this a long time and have a long history of providing technical and financial assistance across the watershed to gateway partners and programmatic partners, this is the first time that our office is running and managing a formal competitive grant. So bear with us as we go. If we don't have answers today, we're collecting questions, and on our landing page on our website, we will be setting up a frequently asked question page. And so we'll just run through today together. We'll do our best, but know that we'll be working hard to answer questions as we go. Okay, so let's head to the next slide. And I'll just start here, and we really always try to start at this level to show and indicate the scale and scope of the role and the responsibilities of the NPS for the Chesapeake watershed. This is a map of the full 41 million acre Chesapeake watershed. So to put that in context, there are over 18 million people that live, work, recreate within this watershed. It's home to hundreds of primary and secondary streams and tributaries that all connect down to and support the health and vitality of the Chesapeake Bay. It's also, to put it in context, 41 million acres is hard sometimes to wrap your head around. A high school football field is about an acre. So picture 41 million high school football fields. That is the scale and scope of the Chesapeake Bay watershed. So our programs that NPS supports and we participate in run from upstate New York all the way down to Virginia tidewaters. Our work relates to the Chesapeake Gateways program, and that's a partnership network and a community assistance program. We'll talk more about that. The NPS also has a primary role in the federal multi-state partnership that's known as the Chesapeake Bay Program. That is the major effort that's been running for almost 40 years to conserve the Bay and its watershed. The EPA is the primary federal partner, lead federal partner for that effort. NPS, under that effort, has responsibilities that really focus on the people aspect of the restoration effort. We help facilitate, manage, and track five of the work groups related to the Chesapeake Bay program. Protected lands, public access, stewardship, diversity, and environmental literacy. We do that through partnerships and through collaboration. Each of those work groups under the Chesapeake Bay program have extensive partners that support the efforts and the work happening across the watershed. The NPS also is the primary partner for what's known as the Chesapeake Conservation Partnership. NPS founded and co-convenes with the Chesapeake Conservancy, that's what we call CCP, the Chesapeake Conservation Partnership. It's a large landscape collaborative of over 50 agencies, land trusts, and community partners that are striving to conserve the watershed. And it has set a stretch goal of conserving 30% of the watershed by 2030. So these are the three big partnerships that the NPS Chesapeake office supports, we lead, we participate in. Next slide. But to focus in on Chesapeake Gateways as our primary legislated program that Congress set up in 2023, we will be celebrating the 25th year of the establishment of the Chesapeake Gateways and Water Trails Network. Again, it's a community assistance program and a partnership network. We're focused on really reviving and reinvesting and recommitting to the Gateways Network. And Gateways, Chesapeake Gateways, is about places, people, stories, equity, and inclusion. There are three main levels of the Gateways Network, and you can see those here, where Gateways includes what are called gateway sites. These are existing parks, refuges, historic sites, museums that are all across the watershed. These are places that tell a piece and share and conserve a piece of what makes the Chesapeake special. They are existing national park sites, existing state parks, historic ports, museums, conserved lands and open spaces. And within that construct, you know, these are in the individual dots that you see on the map. There's also the idea that NPS Chesapeake Gateways functions also at a landscape scale. And so the idea of having Chesapeake landscape regions. So people sometimes often relate better to their locality. So where you see the blue ovals represents the subset of the broader watershed. So for example, the upper Susquehanna or the lower James or the western shore of the Chesapeake or the eastern shore of the Chesapeake, where people align either with their rivers or their landscape region versus the overall Chesapeake. So we function in that way as well. We also are standing up a new approach to begin to bring support, technical assistance, partnership collaboration at a community scale. And so the yellow dots are just representative of the concept of having Chesapeake Gateway communities. Next slide. This is just a snapshot of the authority that we're using for the new grant offering. The Chesapeake Bay Initiative Act of 1998 is our grounding, enabling legislation for our office. It has broad authorities to partner, provide technical and financial assistance with a wide range of entities, and Eddie will help detail that further coming ahead. And it really sets out the framework under which both the Gateways program and partnership functions, as well as our grants program, grants offering. Next slide. So this slide just is intended to help understand the scope of the program for the Chesapeake Gateways. We receive federal appropriations through Congress each year annually. Our authorized amount that we're able to receive is $3 million. The past several years, we have been receiving $3 million for the Gateways program. And those funds go into three primary areas: technical assistance, and that's NPS staff assistance and expertise that we bring out to partners and communities. Also, the funds go towards our cooperative and interagency agreements. So these are financial assistance agreements that include substantial NPS involvement. And the bulk of the support that we have provided for years and years under Gateways falls in this category. And the green box indicates the new offering of adding to the way we bring support out to our partners and communities is the network grants. And those are financial assistance that must include, and all of the assistance should include, carrying out a public purpose with those funds. Next slide. So I'm going to pass it to Eddie here to walk through the new grants offering from NPS Chesapeake Gateways. And again, you know, we'll use the chat feature. And as we go, Rebecca will help us navigate and take time to watch for questions and answer questions as we go. So just want to give a shout out to Bob and Eddie for helping us get to this point. Also to our regional financial assistance office, did just an incredible job to be able to post this offering on grants.gov. And great work from Brent Everett on our team, who is able to get everything up on our website. It really has been a team effort to get us to this day. So with that, Eddie, take it away. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Wendy. Yes, and I'll definitely share, add my thanks too to everybody that got us here. It's definitely been a fun and challenging exercise, but you know, the goal is to provide more support for the network. So it was an easy task in front of us. I am really happy to be here and to be able to walk through the application process. I do want to differentiate this presentation from one we have planned in November, where we're going to do a little more deep dive on the actual application process. This is more the application itself, just to distinguish the two, and you'll get notices of the what's coming up in November later in the slide deck. Also, because we are presenting this for the first time, I do want to underscore the adding questions and comments in the chat so that we can capture what questions you might have. And also, if anything isn't coming across clearly, definitely let us know so that we can make sure we can amend that both in the application itself and on the landing page. So just keep that in mind as we're going through it. And we did already have one question come up in the triad that I want to go ahead and start with as an example. Question came up whether this is a one-time opportunity or will more grants be coming out in the future. We do expect this to be an annual program. This is just year one. So if for whatever reason you're not going to be ready this year, this is definitely something to look forward to in future years. I did want to start by just walking through some of the highlights before we get into the details. You know, we have about $1 million to give away in two grant categories, $25,000 to $50,000 and $51,000 to $150,000. And this is really just to help us manage the scale of projects that we're hoping to see and how many projects we're hoping to support so that we can make sure we're getting some good diversity of sizes of projects. The projects are all going to need to come in one of two categories, inclusive interpretive initiative, or resilient communities and landscapes. And I'll provide more details of those further down in the presentation. This is also a way for us to focus on diversity, equity, inclusion, accessibility, and community engagement. You'll get more details on the actual review criteria and how this is going to be represented. But you know, overall, these are the kind of projects that we want to be able to advance through this opportunity. There's a lot of work being done, and you know, we feel like there's a chance for us to make investments in these areas within the watershed. Another thing to highlight right off the bat is there's no match requirement for this program. So whatever budget you need is the budget you would be requesting, as long as it fits within one of those two grant categories. We, you know, and it competes well, we would hope, we're hoping to fund the entire component. There will be part of the review process that may adjust some of those requests depending on the final availability of funds. But the good thing is you don't have to bring any match requirement to the proposal or included in the proposal. Another thing to highlight is we do have a broad diversity of eligible entities within this grant program, including the private sector, education institutions, nonprofits of various different types. Really the only type of organization that's not allowed to apply is federal agencies, including our national park units. But the partners that work with them would be able to, as long as it's the partner submitting an application. And then also all the projects need to have a public purpose and occur within the watershed. You know, this, there's some little distinction here on the public purpose where there's, we're going to be looking at what is the component that impacts an audience or brings in an audience or really engages an audience that hasn't been engaged before. So we're going to be looking for what is the, not just the activity, but the extent and the reach of that activity in looking at that within that public purpose. And of course, it has to occur within the watershed. And we've got some tools that can help you make sure that that includes your geography. And then finally, you know, a big highlight is we've a pretty extensive application period. Our deadline's not until January 30th. And that's so we can make sure that we are reaching the right kinds of organizations to be aware of this opportunity so that they can prepare proposals. And hopefully it'll give some more organizations some time to rally around this opportunity and come up with a proposal that where they might need a little more time to get through their part of it. That's it on the highlights. Next page, please. So before we jump into the application, you know, the context for us are two strategic documents that got us to the notice that you'll see in just a moment. The first was our framework that was developed with input from various partners, by staff, other units within the Park Service that have their own outreach objectives. So the framework really guides what our vision is for maybe the next 10, 15 years. From that, we distilled it down to a strategic plan that really looks at the next 5 years, of which we are in year two, and the grant program becomes a pivotal point in that strategic plan and being able to provide more support for the network. Both documents really include a lot of information about where we want to be going, what we see on the horizon as far as opportunities. So they provide really good documents to get you familiar with where our office wants to be going and how these grants fit into that strategy. Next slide, please. Now, there are four strategic themes outlined in the strategic plan. This grant program is going to focus on two of them: advance a major inclusive interpretive initiative with an equity lens, and promote resilient communities and landscapes through tourism, sustainability, conservation, and local economies. The reality is, with 18 million people living in the watershed, it's more apparent that a lot of the activities that are happening at the regional, local, and individual level influence the things that are happening in the Bay. Not only the watershed, but the rivers that are included in it, the climates they sustain, the landscapes, and the communities themselves. For us, these two areas really include a lot of the different types of projects that we've been investing in the past. But now we want to open this up to what are the things out there that we don't know about that we should have on our radar that we can capture through these network grants. Things like ecological health, human health, economic vigor, equity, public access, quality of life. There's an interconnectedness to all of those things within the watershed. And there's folks out there like you that are working in some of those aspects that are worth investing in by the Park Service. So those are the kind of projects we're hoping to see in one of these two grant categories. Next slide, please.
Whoops.
So the first one I'll go into a little more detail is the Advance a Major Interpretive Initiative with an Equity Lens. You know, the Chesapeake Gateways Network brings in narratives from all over. When you look at all the different landscapes that are represented, the stories, the people, the histories, just the natural landscapes as well, there's so much going on and so much that has gone on in our watershed that we need those connections to really tell the full story. And we need the folks that represent those connections. So through this program, we hope to engage underrepresented places, help tell underrepresented and full stories, facilitate galvanizing conservation and quality of life, and strengthening the ladder of engagement. Next slide. We have some sample actions that would fall under this category. This is not a checklist. This is not meant to be, we can definitely do that. Let's do that. But it's really meant to give you a frame for the kinds of things we're going to be looking for as samples. There's more in the strategic plan, and you can get this kind of information from reading through the strategic plan. But I just wanted to emphasize the aspects of what we're looking for. You know, we are looking for developing meaningful relationships and engagement with the underrepresented people and places. We're looking to assess and understand your diverse communities. You're in the best position to let us know what is best for the communities you represent. We're looking to link culture and nature in ways that aren't currently seen. Again, you know best how these connections can be fruitful at the local level. We want to be able to support that. And then building ladders of youth engagement in particular, providing opportunities through our programs where there's places for youth to go, to learn, to experience, and then make decisions about where they want to go next. Included in this is understanding of demographics and the stories that they're coming from. You know, essentially, what are the stories that are being told? Who is telling them? And what stories are not being told? And who needs to be telling those stories? Next slide. So the other strategic theme is promote resilient communities and landscapes. There's a lot of rich heritage still at work in the Chesapeake. There's living history that represents, you know, centuries of prior history, the changing landscapes between who's lived where and you know, the growth of our country and how it was represented in the watershed. Has left a footprint of communities that were and communities that are. So looking at that lens and the ways that the Chesapeake is still a working landscape, we want to be able through these network grants to promote and market the Chesapeake watershed experience and what and the diversity that includes. We want to promote a stewardship ethic so that people aren't just getting these experiences, but those experiences lead to some sort of connection to the people, places, and land. And we also want to facilitate collaboration for landscape and community conversation. There's power in getting aggregating effort and getting more people involved in these efforts. We also want to advance equitable access to the outdoors. You know, the landscape has been changing and sometimes in more restrictive ways. So how can we really try to counter that from a public access point of view and make sure that we're giving people the opportunity to get outdoors and recreate and utilize the bay for you know, personal health, for their own recreation and hobbies and interests. And then also grow the landscape and heritage-based sustainable economies. You know, these are the moving pieces in the Chesapeake that we want to continue to have movement in, and how we can do that to the grants is what we're going to be looking at. Next slide, please. Again, not meant to be a checklist, but just to highlight some of the types of projects that fall in here. It would be projects that make public lands and open spaces more welcoming and accessible. We've had some discussions recently about you go to some of these spaces and you see the regulatory signs, but you don't really see the here's what you can do here signs. So it's adding that component of invitation and welcome to some of these spaces and orientation to what can be done. The land conservation and public access, that there's, conservation and public access happening through collaborations across the watershed to really amplify that impact. Linking nature-based and cultural tourism to gateways. Again, it's that connection to utilizing assets and driving visitorship so that that really supports the economies that local communities rely on. And then specifically connecting with underrepresented communities. There are rich stories that really need to be accessed by everyone that has an interest in those stories. How can we make those connections stronger and more expansive? And then really bringing in new audiences to these stories. These aren't secrets to hold dear, they're secrets to share and really to shout on the riverbanks and hilltops. Next slide, please.
Hey, before we move on to digging into some of the award information, I just wanted to pause and see if there are any questions that folks have about those two themes. So either pop them in the chat or raise your hand. Just anything that before we get into some more details, folks might have top of mind. I'll point out that Wendy linked the strategic plan in the chat. And so make sure that you're downloading that where you can get some more information. Jill, you can definitely do both. If you have a question, that'll be easier for you to just ask real quick. You can definitely come off mute now and ask your question.
Well, it was just that, I think some of the projects I could see there being an overlap space between both themes. And so I wanted to know if we have to write towards one of them or if it's pulling on both themes, if that's okay.
Yeah, you can pull on both themes. It just needs to be clear that you're hitting at least one, but certainly can in your narrative be clear that you're intending to have results or outcomes that achieve both themes. And one piece that I would share about the resilient communities is for NPS Chesapeake Gateways, when we talk about resilient communities, we're really meaning the true nexus with people. So our funding is not at a level and at a scope that we would be able to fund green infrastructure or big infrastructure type projects. So there are other agencies, state agencies, federal agencies that are able to do those bigger sort of resiliency types of projects. When we're talking about promoting resilient communities, we are talking about the people, the nexus to access and the connections to authentic Chesapeake industries and experiences. Sustaining livelihoods while conserving resources is really a key component of our work. So things like farming and fishing and heritage tourism and access to nature, all the things that make the Chesapeake so special. And those are the things that where we would consider that's what makes a community and partners and places resilient is by supporting that kind of work.
Thank you for that clarity, Wendy. Eddie, do you have something you want to add to that before we move on?
Wendy just jogged that one of the things I forgot to mention about the resilient communities for me personally is that, I was at a training a while back and I latched onto two quotes that came out of that training. It was a training on community engagement that really for me drives everything I do now, especially within that resilient communities strategic theme. And it was this concept of nothing about us without us, that, if you're talking about a community, that community really should be involved in the conversation. And the other one is the solution to community challenges is in the community. To be purposeful about going into communities, finding out what their needs are and being responsive, not prescriptive in what you're coming up with. So we hope that there's going to be I'm excited to see what comes in both of those strategic themes, because there's a lot of things I think that would be worth investing in. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm. I think we'll jump into the other section now. We have one more question that came into the chat, and Wendy might have you look at that while Eddie continues on.
Sure, thanks. We'll get to that question in just a minute. Thank you.
Yes, and this is exactly how we want this to be working. So definitely keep throwing questions into the chat, even if we need to follow up with them. So moving on then, a little more detail on the award information. Again, about $1 million to fund. The exact number, we won't know until we see how the projects come out within the two grant categories. It is going to be one application, so you're not having to submit a different application for the different levels. No one proposal can be more than $150,000. If you're looking to address both of the strategic themes, you'll note that in the narrative, but the budget itself can only be $150,000 for any particular project as a max. But as you can see within the two funding levels, we do expect to have more smaller grants be awarded than larger. And this is just to be practical with the amount of funding that we have at $150,000, that million will go quick. So we know there's a lot of need out there because this is year one and we're also calibrating where our support is most needed. We're hoping that you are able to distill down your needs to one of these two funding levels. And so we can really focus on where there's an ability to make strategic impact within that. Let me just check my notes. And then, just to reemphasize the no cost share requirement, some of the projects that you're promoting or submitting may already have other budgets associated with it, but our review team will really only be looking at the part of the budget that you're going to be submitting for support. And then also to emphasize that these projects need to take place in the watershed. Applicants from outside the watershed can apply, but the work itself needs to reside within the watershed. And there's a link in the slide deck that you'll get afterwards that has a list of all the counties, so you can double check to make sure that your site is included.
All right. So there's two questions that have come in the chat that I'll just run through quick. So one has come in asking about a mountain bike trail system in a local state park. And whether that's an appropriate project to submit. If it matches the increasing access to the outdoors, if it hits on those two themes. And then you'll see in a minute when Eddie runs through the criteria, if it's hitting the criteria, we're really taking this approach of like, bring it on, right? Submit projects. Part of what we're hoping we discover is really what the scale and scope of the need is out there, because this will become an annual grant program, an annual grant offering. It's helpful to understand what the opportunities and needs are out there. So I would say, if you see that you're fitting a theme, at least one, maybe two, if you're meeting the criteria that you'll see in a minute, consider applying. The question about, can you have two projects, one for 50K, another, for 100K? You can, they each have to be submitted separately. So that's up to you and your organization if that is something you want to do, two separate submissions. It means a separate budget, separate narrative, and Eddie will go through the pieces of the application. So you can, it just means double the submission.
Yeah, I would also read that as, because you're, the total would be 150, which is our max. You could put them into one, but then you're.
I'm sorry, I didn't see that. Yep.
Well, I was seeing it as both. I thought the question was the way you had answered it too, but I think the other caveat is you could bring them in as one, but then if it doesn't compete well because it's larger amount, neither are going to get funded. So it's still that same, Rebecca. You'll have to just make the determination of what increases your chances, which one is the better is the one that you'd like to see by splitting them up and doubling your chances. That'll be the only limits we have, is it's got to fit within the 150 max.
Okay, so let's keep going. We have a lot to cover still, and we want to make sure we get through through each of the pieces of the announcement.
And a lot of this is defined in the landing page that you'll get a link to at the end, as well as the actual application. So there's got a lot more detail. You can go through that. This is really just the surface descriptions. But on the eligible entities, this is the complete list. I'm really hoping that everybody on this call sees themselves somewhere on this list. It's a pretty diverse list of entities that are eligible to apply. I did want to highlight some points from this list. You'll notice that the federal government is not listed. National parks or other federal agencies are not eligible to apply to this program. However, partners of federal agencies are, and that includes park partners, but the proposal needs to be submitted by the partner in order to be considered. For any applicant, the proposed project must provide a public benefit. So, projects that are restoring or conserving, the activity itself has to be described in terms of having a public purpose, not just the activity itself, but the connection to having a public purpose. And then, what its scale is going to be within the watershed. And let me look at my notes. Also some of the, we did get a question about organizations that have sites within and external to the watershed. Unfortunately, we would only be focused on the parts of the organization conducting these projects within the watershed frame as well. So that would be something for you to consider when you are applying. And if you received past financial assistance from the Chesapeake Bay office through other means, you're still eligible to apply. The review and the process really looks at this as an independent financial assistance mechanism. So we'll be doing the reviews based on what you include in the application. All right, now to we're going to start getting more into the weeds. I apologize. Again, a lot of this is detailed with a lot more information in the application. So after the program, feel free to jump over to our landing page or to the actual application to do a little bit more deeper dive. But, a quick walkthrough of the elements of the application. There's going to be some standard forms that you'll see as you log into grants.gov and get into the application that you'll be asked to fill in. They're pretty standard if you've ever done federal grants. For anybody that's new to the process, there's a lot of help resources and how-tos on some of these forms, either on YouTube or on the grants.gov page that can serve as resources for you. But there'll be an application cover sheet, the SF-424. There'll be a budget worksheet, the SF-424A. And then there's going to be the elements that you'll have to submit through the various different steps, a project abstract that you'll provide, the detailed budget, the indirect costs. So these are rates that either have been predetermined or are the default 10% for writing in indirect costs into the budget, as well as assurances that all organizations applying for federal funds will need to convey. And those forms are all detailed in the application. The bigger piece probably for the review committee will be the project narrative. There are additional requirements that may apply based on the project that you're submitting, potentially some approvals that would need to be secured before the project would be awarded, but those would be conveyed when we get to the selection process. Next slide, please. On the project narrative, again, this is the piece where you're going to be giving us a lot of the information about what you're looking for. A lot of the other pieces are forms that you fill out. Those, there'll be information there for the reviewers as well. But the project narrative is your opportunity to tell us, to describe the challenge that you're looking to address, describe the benefits, describe the opportunities, the audiences, all the different pieces that are going to let the review committee understand why your proposal is worth the investment. Some quick highlights. We have an 8-page limit to make, you know, make it a little bit easier for the reviewers to go through all the applications that we will receive. That includes text, figures, and references. So really any of the topical pieces. We have made accommodations for some of the optional components that I'll mention in a second, but things like the project team resumes, the required forms, those do not count against your 8-page limit. And we're hoping to keep everyone at an 11-point font with 1-inch margins, again, just for the ease of our reviewers going through all the applications. We're also really only going to be focused on what you are looking to get support for. Anything extraneous or anything that you include that's not part of what's been requested will not be considered. And that's really also to provide a fair review horizon for everybody that's applied. Next slide. The project narrative. So this is where a lot of the things that are already rolling around in your head, the things that you've already been thinking about, this is where you'll want to capture that. So starting with the project overview, what is it? What are you looking to do? What would be the impact? You know, who would you be looking to engage would be included in that. Within strategic intent, this is how does the project connect to our strategic themes? There's a lot of things that are probably going to be worth investing in the watershed, but we're going to need to have that connection back to one of our two strategic themes. And this is where you would include that connection. And then on organization and application overview, we want to know about you, you know, the applicant, what team members are going to be working on this? How does this fit within your mission and objectives and goals that you're trying to advance within the watershed? Again, these we're calling these network grants because you all represent the network, and we want to be able to invest in members of the network. So this is how you can then let us know who's in the network. And then the last piece are some optional narrative components. Again, they don't count towards your 8-page limit. They include project resumes of key project contacts and then letters of support for proposals that are working with additional partners or collaborations. This will be an opportunity for you to include those. The optional narrative components will not count against you if you don't include them, but you know it is just another opportunity for you to let us know more about the what you've arranged, what you're really thinking about, and who's going to be working together to get that accomplished.
Eddie, before you move into priorities, mm-hmm. there is one question in the chat that I think the overarching question is pretty interesting, and would this grant support trail construction? So I think as we're looking at construction and trail construction, is that something that folks should be thinking about as they're thinking about applying?
Yeah, I just wrote back to Jen to say, is it a federal site? If it's a federal park, a wildlife refuge, a federal, you know, a national forest, we wouldn't be able to because there can't be a direct, these grants, while they can go to federal partners to do projects, it can't be for the sole benefit of that federal entity. So a trail would really on federal property would be a hard one to fund for us because it would fall in that category of there's a direct, you know, benefit to the federal agency.
But for on private.
Or, you know, or state or, you know, some non-federal.
Yes, not federal.
Yes. Yeah.
All right. And then specifically about the narratives, will the narratives be viewed digitally or hard copy? So are hyperlinks going to be something that could be included in the narrative?
That is a good question.
It's run through the grants.gov portal. So there's a, you know, there's a process in the portal. So I would want to save that question for our next series of workshops to be able to answer that. And I apologize for not having that ready to go in this round. One of the questions that was in here, just to circle around again with the question about the trails, the answer was it's privately owned nature preserve. As long as any of the projects that individuals, entities, groups are submitting for the grants has a public purpose and then meets the themes and the criteria, it's, you know, largely that's the entry point. You know, if the intent was to create a trail system that the public does not have access or benefit from, unlikely to be funded, you know. So public purpose is sort of the first gated entry into the grants. And then the major themes are two big themes, and then the criteria that Eddie will run through in just 1 minute.
Yeah, this starts getting us into eligibility versus competitiveness. And unfortunately, you know, the eligibility is really the only thing that we can define for you through this, the application. It's the eligible applicants, the thematic, the strategic themes, the funding levels and the amounts. Those are the limits. You know, if you're within one of those limits or within all of those limits, you can, you're likely eligible to apply. What we really can't convey and have a sense of is the competitiveness of how well that project is going to compete against other projects. But to give you a little bit of sense of what we are going to want to be investing in, you know, we'll get into the criteria, but I want to start with this priorities list. You know, we are looking for what is, these are investments. Where is there going to be return on investment? So that either in terms of elevating a scope or audience of an existing program or investing in projects or programs that expand inclusive programming to address barriers. So again, with the trail example, it's not enough to contemplate a trail. It's contemplating a trail, either utilizing a underrepresented group to help build and help utilize and help, you know, create some sort of ownership. So we're going to want to see what those bigger scale connections are to these activities, not just the activity itself. And then, or proposals that kick off new efforts, new strategies, new innovative designs that would be difficult for you to invest on your own. Those are the places where we want to be as an office. We are encouraging proposals that include and uplift partnerships. You know, we're looking to expand the network. We're looking to, you know, make sure more people feel like they are part of the network. And that a lot of that's going to be done through the collaborations that you bring to the table. We are highlighting that these aren't meant to support annual maintenance or operations. You know, even if those are eligible, they may not be competitive because, again, we're looking at impact and the outcomes that are going to come from these investments. And in a lot of those cases, it can't just be whatever physical space is being left behind. It's the utility of that physical space. Next slide. There's another section very well detailed in both the application and in our landing page, so you can get a lot more information here, but I'll go through each of the five criteria that the reviewers will be utilizing individually, but let me run through them real quick. Connection to Chesapeake Gateway strategic themes. We've talked a little bit about that. It's got to connect to at least one of the two. Connection to equity, inclusion, accessibility, and engagement objectives. This is where that investment and the outcomes that we're looking at comes into play. Innovation and project intent. What are you looking to do? Clarity of the project's operational plan. Can you do what you're saying you're going to do? And then capacity to implement the project. Are the right people in place to be able to conduct that? So we'll go a little bit deeper into each of the individual ones. Next slide, please. The first one connecting to, and I we did include the weighting factors, so you can kind of see how they'll be compared against each other. All of these factors will be weighed on a 0 to 10 point scale allow for that variability of the different reviewers. But the weighting factor is listed here. So the first one is connection to strategic themes. A lot of great ideas, but they're really going to have to connect to one of those two themes as outlined in the application. You can get a lot more information about what we mean in the strategic plan if you're unsure. But in reality, the reviewers are going to be evaluating how successfully the projects can connect to one or more of the two strategic themes. Next slide. connection to equity, inclusion, accessibility, and engagement. This is where, you know, the reviewers are going to be looking at how well the proposal is incorporating these elements into the design, into the implementation. There's going to be easily projects you could just pull right off the shelf, slap a cover letter on it and submit it. Unless it's got that extra level of detail about the utility of these projects within equity, inclusion, accessibility, and engagement, it's likely not going to compete as well as other projects that do. So just keep that in mind. You know, how does the project build long-term relationships with underrepresented communities to address community identified needs? How is the intended audience engaged in the project? Those will be some of the key questions that the reviewers ask. Next question, next slide, please. Innovation and project intent. So here, you know, you're really looking at the, what are you expecting to get out of this and how is that coming across in the proposal? So the reviewers are going to evaluate the innovativeness of what you're proposing and its ability to address what you say you're looking to address. So that the project intent really should match up. If you say this is the project, the problem, the proposal that you're seeking support for should really be designed to address that problem. Otherwise, the two aren't going to connect for the reviewers. Next slide. Clarity of the project's operational plan. You know, we want to see that you have mapped this out, that you have considered the different steps that you're going to need to pull this together, that you have a sense of the outputs that you're expecting that will lead to the outcomes that you have addressed as what can be, you know, how investing in your proposal will benefit the community and provide that public purpose. So the reviewers are going to look at the budget, the project narrative, how well all of those things are conveyed in what you are putting in front of the proposal. And this is why it's really important to really think about all they're going to look at is what's in that narrative and in the forms that you submit. So don't rely on, oh, they'll know that we did this, you know, or that we have this kind of history. You really need to document it and quantify it in the proposal. And the last one is team's capacity to implement the project. Again, we want everybody that's gets an award to be successful, because that means that the outcomes that you listed in your proposal are going to be achieved. So the more that you can convey to us your ability to provide the leadership, provide the infrastructure, provide the organization as an applicant is going to be helpful to the reviewers. You know, they're going to be looking at the skills that the organization represents, the expertise that they're highlighting that will be needed. Any, you know, here's where the partnership letters might potentially come into play. A lot more information on those in the grant application. So feel free to jump in. And if any questions come up, definitely forward them to us for clarification. A quick overview of the selection review and selection process. It's got multiple levels. There'll be an initial review for that'll happen internally. And this is really to ensure that it's an application from an eligible entity, that all the forms, the required forms are included, that all the different elements that we've asked for are included in the application, and that there is that strategic connection to one of the two themes. From there, it goes to the review committee. They'll utilize the review criteria that we just discussed to quantify each of the proposals that come in and establish a recommended slate of candidates to award. Those will go to the superintendent, to Wendy. Well, we'll be looking as an office, various different factors like geographic distribution, diversity of the awardees, thematic distribution, and how many funds we have available to make the final case for selection. And then as Wendy mentioned, those then get forwarded on to the regional office to get finalized. And then we work with the region to do all the official notifications for the awardees and those not selected.
So Eddie, before you move on to the schedule, that was a lot of information. So I just want to pause and make sure that folks have an opportunity to either get their questions in the chat or ask them. In response, there is a landing page that has all the information about the grant. This presentation, the presentation later this week, and the ones in November that we've been referencing are all going to be recorded. So you'll have the ability to watch those if you want to get caught up that way. But all of the questions that we're capturing here will be capturing in those sessions and that come in through this process will be up on that landing page. So if you ask a question and we don't have an answer, there will be one and we'll get that out and posted. And then there was a question about innovation and what does innovation mean? Does it have to be something new that we haven't done before? And Wendy, you said that it can be something that you're building on or expanding. It could be something that's existing, but looking at new ways of doing it or scaling it or growing it.
The grant can cover salaries or fees for hiring staff to achieve whatever the project or, you know, outcome is or, so yes, in your detailed budget, when you submit, you would identify those pieces. Yes.
Great. Keep those questions coming. Thanks, everyone. Really quickly, the next couple of slides, you know, just some walking you through what's coming up next. So our schedule for the rest of the timeline for this grant cycle, well, applications open until January 30th. From there, we go into the review process that I just mentioned, and then ending with an award communications going out, as well as declinations. And then hopefully, if everything goes to plan, we're hoping for awards and periods of performance to start over the summer. Unfortunately, the final dates for that, we won't know until we get further into the review process, but these are the targets. And then as Rebecca and Wendy were both mentioning, we do have a repeat of today plan. So if you wanna just walk through this all over again, you're free to register for Thursday's session. It will be an exact repeat of today's program. Both today and Thursdays are being recorded. So on the landing page, you'll have a link to our YouTube channel where you can get them. And then looking ahead to November, we do have a workshop plan where we'll be walking through an overview of the application. We're gonna be walking more into the submission process, grants.gov, SAM, and the notice itself. So that's planned for November.
Next and slide. Eddie, there is a specific question about the grant timeline itself post-award and how long is the period of performance for the actual award?
Great question. Thanks. I realized that wasn't detailed in here. We're hoping projects will come in about 1 to 2 years timeframes. That'll be listed in the NOFO, in the notice. So that's the scale of the projects we're hoping for. So that period of performance starting sometime over the summer, that will mark that the start of that 1 to 2 year mark. That's the target we're looking at for these kinds of projects.
And Wendy, maybe you can clarify just a little bit more about the staff hiring. There have been a lot of questions that have come in on that. So what the grant does cover hiring and creating staff or just...
Right, yeah. Right. And maybe a way to think about it is the grant is for a outcome, a product, a deliverable that can, of course, be done and conducted by staff. It wouldn't necessarily be that the grant would just cover a position because then that falls in the category of like annual operations. So it could be existing staff that achieve the product program deliverable, but it wouldn't be a case that you would just submit to cover a annual operating costs of a position, if that helps to make the difference.
Yeah, remember we're crossing into there's eligibility versus competitiveness. And in some of these cases, it may be allowed, but it won't be competitive. And we unfortunately won't know that until we see what is actually being proposed. So you definitely want to keep that in mind before you submit so you don't go through, if this isn't the right opportunity to support a need. But it comes back to that, that, you know, like Wendy was saying, the outputs and the outcomes that you're wanting to ensure, you're going to need to make a case that those staff dollars, that's how it aggregates.
I think that was helpful. Thank you both.
All right. We're getting right towards the end, y'all. So thanks for holding with us. As far as getting yourself ready, and we're going to do a little bit more details on this in the next one, just so you can already start thinking about what comes next, make sure that all applications for federal awards need to start with a SAM registration, System for Award Management. So if you're new to federal granting, this would be the first place for you to start before you go over to grants.gov or our landing page. Register with SAM. Once you're there, there'll be a process for you to get a unique identity identifier. This will be your number that you'll utilize whenever you're applying and referencing your application. For those that are familiar with this, replaces the old DUNS number that you would have gotten from Dun & Bradstreet. It's now being done through SAM.gov. I do want to highlight, because our folks have highlighted to us, that there is no cost to do this. There are a lot of third-party groups out there that will try to pitch you to have them do it for you at a cost. You know, we can't tell you don't use them, because it's putting their services available to you, but you don't need that to run the process. There are tutorials on grants.gov and on sam.gov, as well as YouTube, on how to go through their processes. So if you need assistance, start there first before you consider a vendor to do that for you. And then, you know, this is part of a larger series of conversations we're having with the network. Again, it's all part of really reinforcing the network, strengthening the network, and bringing more people into the network. If you're listening to this, you are part of that network. So beyond the grants, we'll also be having some gateway chats on components of becoming a gateway community that would be beneficial whether you're applying or not. And then we're also contemplating a Gateways annual conference next year that'll happen sometime after we close the grant application process. And that'll be so we can convey best practices, look at the last 25 years of our office, and really start looking at some forecasting of where we should be going with the larger Chesapeake Bay Gateways community program.
Great. One more question has popped in that I think is a really important question for us to answer about: can multiple parties apply and collaborate on a project? One would have to be the lead. So that collaboration and partnerships for submitting a grant.
Yeah, I just wrote a quick response. There would need to be one applicant, but a collaborative approach is a viable submission. And actually the NOFO has a section that speaks to partnerships, and that the network is all about partnerships and collaboration, and that is a positive strength for a submission.
So we explained a lot. There was a lot in these slides. You're going to get the slides, so at least you'll be able to go back to them. But there's a lot more out there for you as far as resources. We've aggregated them on a grants landing page for these network grants. You'll see the link there, and you'll see it on the closing slide as well. Take a moment to dive in there, you know, see what else we've included. There's links to the YouTube channel with some of the other recordings that we have in there. There's links to the application itself. And then very shortly, there'll also be a link to the FAQ. And we'll send that notice out to everybody that registered for today and Thursday on the FAQ when it's available, so you know so you have a heads up as somebody that's come to this workshop, to this webinar. I did want to make one note with that respect, though, about some of the questions that have been coming in have been very project specific. And unfortunately, what we can convey to you is your ability to be eligible. So if you are in the Chesapeake, if you're on that list of eligible applicants, if your project fits within one of those two strategic themes, if it can be accomplished within the timeframe and the funding that we have available, you should put forward an application. What we unfortunately cannot do is advise you on competitiveness or, you know, really help you design a program that then you would turn into an application. So hopefully a lot of that detail is captured in the application to help you within the criteria, within the strategic theme explanations, to give you a sense of whether you want to submit an application or not. And then those FAQs are going to have a lot of these scenarios answered for you as well when that comes out. So definitely make some time to check it out. All right, closing slide. Any questions that come up, send them to this email address, Chesapeake_grants@nps.gov, so we can capture them and convey them in the FAQ. And then if you're looking for more details and want to go ahead and start contemplating a proposal, that's the link to the landing page, and you can get a link to the application from there. Great. Thank you, everyone. And I'll turn it back to Wendy for closing comments.
Yeah. Thanks, Eddie. I just want to close by saying, you know, that we're thrilled to be able to be offering this grant opportunity. We are trying to make it as accessible and inclusive as possible. We are bound by the structures of federal grants. So for as much as we're trying, we know that there's still barriers. It's important for us to understand what those are so that as this is going to become our annual offering. And so we want to learn about those barriers and understand how we can keep working to make it more accessible. So send in those questions, use that that email address, Chesapeake_grants@nps.gov to send in information, because we really are looking to advance this bold new strategy to strengthen the Chesapeake Gateways network, to gather and share the full diversity of Chesapeake stories, to expand land conservation, provide equitable access to recreation, history, and nature. We're looking to support local and working economies at a community level. So those traditional, authentic Chesapeake industries that, you know, that really make the Chesapeake special. We're looking to engage really an inclusive and deep Chesapeake stewardship and resiliency movement that benefits us all. So that is the essence of what we're hoping our grants begin to invest in and encourage and expand across the watershed. So we're hopeful that we get a lot of applications. Those that we're not able to fund, we're already starting to think through how with across the network we can think about future funding years and or other opportunities beyond our own grant offering. So, you know, bring the needs and ideas in and then we'll go from there together.
Looking forward to it. Hope to see you in the applicant pool.
Thank you all. Feel free to join the second call. That is Thursday afternoon, same time. And then register for the workshops in November.